Good morning. I'd like to welcome you to our service this morning. I'm really glad to have you. If you're new, if you're a visitor, we're just really glad that you're here. Please feel free, at the back, there's actually a little coffee mug. It has lots of treats and literature. And it also has a connection card. So this will just give us a chance to get to know you better, to fill it out and be able to contact you and just to see if we can serve you in some way. So please do, if you feel inclined, to pick that up, and that's our gift to you this morning. A couple announcements. So I want to remind you guys that upcoming we have a Resolve teaching series. So this will be taking the place of the LAG over the summer. So instead of our discussion group, our life application group, we'll have a summer series. And so please stay tuned in your email this week for details on that, of the schedule and what some of the topics will be. So please stay tuned for that. And then also want to remind you that immediately after the service today, we'll be having a potluck fellowship meal. And even if you didn't bring something to share, please join us. Please stay. We'd just be really glad to have you join us for a meal after the service today. And also, I guess, thirdly and lastly, it is Father's Day, so happy Father's Day to all of our dads. You really play an important role in the life of the family and the life of the church, and so we just want to honor you this morning. And I know that as Christians, we do live in a fallen world. We know that earthly fathers, they can cause pain, they can cause hardship. This notion is difficult for some people, this notion of fatherhood. And so we want to recognize that, but we also want as Christians to celebrate fathers and fatherhood. We know that this is a role that God himself has established. We know that Christian fathers are called to love, protect, and provide for our families. And really, when fathers get it right, they have the unique opportunity to paint a picture of the Heavenly Father. And that's also on the flip side of that. When dads and fathers get it wrong, it's often a stumbling block for people to understand and to think about our Father in heaven. And so I wanted to read, as our call to worship, an excerpt from Psalm 27, and it says this. I lost my place, so let me flip to it really quick. But the 27th Psalm, I'm just going to kind of skim over it a little bit. But it says, "One thing I have asked of the Lord that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will lift me high upon a rock." And skipping forward, it says, "You have said, 'Seek my face.' My heart says to you, 'Your face, Lord, do I seek. Hide not your face from me. Turn not your servant away in anger. O you who have been my help, cast me not off, forsake me not, O God of my salvation. For my father and my mother have forsaken me, but the Lord will take me in." And all throughout scriptures, you get breadcrumbs, you get pictures of what our Father in heaven is like. What does it mean that God is our Father? And ultimately, the question this morning for our catechism question is really another answer to that question of what God is like as our Father. And it's really the ultimate answer to that question, in that as our Father, he's provided for us his one and only Son to redeem us, to reconcile us to himself. And so it's a very, a really short question this morning and a short answer. So I think I'll just read the question and answer, and I'll have all of us read the supplementary text in Isaiah. But it says, "What sort of redeemer is needed to bring us back to God?" And if you think about that question, I think implicit in that is that God desires redemption. We are rebels. We've rejected him. We've turned against him. And yet, despite that he desires to have reconciliation. He desires to have redemption. So what kind of a redeemer is needed to bring us back to God as our Father, as our adopted Father? And to do that, the answer is, that was really a conundrum, a quandary for God to kind of to bring that about. It wasn't an easy, trivial task. And so what needed to bring that about? The answer is one who is truly human, so one that is like us in all of our weaknesses and all of our frailties, and one who is also truly God. That would be a perfect sacrifice that God would accept. And so we know that that God-man is Jesus Christ himself, and he is the one that has redeemed us back to our Heavenly Father. So we're truly grateful for that this morning. And so let's read, as our call to worship, Isaiah 9, verse 6. It says this, "For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Let's bow our heads and pray. Father, we come before you. I thank you that we can call you Father. That's not a small thing. Your word says that you are a Heavenly Father, that you care for us. And we know that we can only call you Father because of the great sacrifice that you provide on our behalf, that you provided your one and only Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, as a atoning sacrifice for our sin, and that you've redeemed us, that you've brought us back to yourself, and that we can call you Father. I do pray for all the men in the church. I pray that you, that our fathers, that our dads, I pray that you would just bless them this morning. I pray that you would help us to live in a way that is filled with integrity and character, and that you give us strength and wisdom and grace to lead our families well, and for all of us to, as men, to paint a picture of what it means to have relationship with the Father, the one who, to whom we will all return one day. I just do pray for our service this morning. I pray that you be glorified. I pray that you be welcome here, that you would be honored and pleased with our worship, with our song, and that you be glorified. I pray that our hearts would be just in tune to what you have for us, that we'd be open and receptive. And we do look forward to the day when our Savior, Jesus Christ, returns again, and that we can all worship him together in his presence. And so we do pray that you'd hasten that day. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
We have about 25 or so students and leaders who are away this week from our church. They left very early Saturday morning. They had to be here at 4:45 at the church on Saturday morning in order to make their way to Richmond and catch their flight out to Minnesota. And so we want to be remembering them, I hope, this week as you think about our students on their Envision Missions trip there in Minneapolis, that you'll be remembering them and praying for them. And we just want to remember them this morning. We also today have a privilege of being able to receive some new members into our church family. It's always a delight when God brings new families, new individuals into our church, and they express the desire to be able to join our church in a formal way. And so I'm going to ask a few of them, all of them who are going to be here this morning. There's one couple that is joining but can't today. They'll be doing that next week. But I would like to ask each of those who are joining this morning if you would please come forward. Kim Lervold, James and Annette Pennis, Kathy Boddicker, and Steve and Joy Zerwinski. And if you would just join with me up here on the platform. As we receive these individuals, I want to make a brief statement to our church family in terms of why do we do membership in the first place? Why is membership important? And I'd like for you to understand that there are three parts to membership that are critical. First of all, membership is a public declaration that God has brought an individual or family to join a particular fellowship of his family. And so when we all know that when we come to faith in Jesus Christ, we are joined to his family the moment we come to faith. But membership is a way of publicly declaring that not only has God joined me to his family worldwide, but God has also joined me to a local fellowship where I am going to be able to live out the realities of God's grace in my life in fellowship with other believers. Secondly, not only is it a public declaration of that, but it's a public confession of their commitment to Jesus Christ and to his church. It's an open commitment and confession that God has worked in my life, and because of that, I'm in relationship with his family, and I'm committed to his bride and to his work. And then lastly, it's a public submission, meaning that God has called us not only to relationship to himself and to one another, but to submit ourselves to the leadership that he gives to us in his word and through his shepherds that he puts into our lives. And so membership is an opportunity to visibly put on display that I'm willingly committing myself to Christ's leadership and his leadership of me as he has given me spiritual leaders in my life that are expressed in a church family. And so I want the church body to understand why we do membership. This is not salvation. This is an expression of our salvation already achieved in Jesus Christ and our adoption as his children and our joining of the body of Christ. To each one of you, I'd like to read a brief passage of Scripture and then make a comment to you. Would you hear the word of God to you? This is Ephesians chapter 4. I therefore, a prisoner of the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. There is one body, one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. In this passage of Scripture, there are multiple places where the Apostle Paul says to us that we are called to certain things. And so I want to urge you, as you have joined this church, that you will live out that call that God has given to you. First of all, you're called to one hope. There is one hope for salvation, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. There is no hope in man, and the Lord alone is their salvation. Secondly, you're called to walk in a manner worthy of his calling. God has called you into relationship with himself, and he has called you to become holy as he is holy. Paul speaks about it as living in humility and gentleness and in mutually serving one another. Third, you're called to walk in love with God's family, to express God's love for you as you love other people. And then lastly, you're called to serve the body with your gifts. The Lord has entrusted to you gifts that he would have you to bless his family with those. And so we are called to use those gifts for the betterment of his children and his family. And so I urge you today, as you join this family, that you will live out that reality. And you cannot do that on your own. You will need God's strengthening and his spirit and his enabling. But this is what the Lord has called us to. There's a few commitments that we will ask you to make. You've already received these ahead of time, so you're not getting anything sprung on you. But we would like you to commit to these, and then I will ask the church body for a commitment to them. Will you submit to the oversight and care of the spiritual shepherding of the Stanton Alliance Church elders who watch over your soul and will give an account to God for their care? If so, say, I do. Will you support this ministry with your regular attendance and with the use of your time, your talent, and your treasure as God will enable you? If so, say, I do. Will you seek to be a blessing to others here with your wisdom and care and urging them to walk in their walk with Jesus? If so, say, I will. Will you embrace the message and ministry and mission of Stanton Alliance Church, as well as the Christian and Missionary Alliance, as a faithful expression of the will of God for our community and the world? If so, say, I will. And will you, church family, pledge to receive these as God has brought them to this body as full members of the grace of God, committing yourselves to serve, love, and encourage them in the grace of Christ, as long as God gives you, and as many often as God gives you opportunity. If so, say, we will. Would you pray with me? Father in heaven, it's a delight for us to have received these your servants, these your children, whom you have rescued and delivered out of the clutches of darkness and sin and death through the blood of Jesus Christ shed for them on the cross. But not only by their salvation, but Lord, in your wisdom and grace, you've placed them in your church. And we here, Lord, have gathered together by the providence of God to be a faithful expression of the church of Jesus Christ. Now enable us, Lord, to live out the callings to which you have given to us, that we might know that there is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one Father, who is over all and in all. We bless them in the name of Jesus, and we receive them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. It's to you we pray. Amen. Thank you, guys. Before we are able to enter into some time of worship through praise and song, I do want to take a moment to welcome Chris and Faith Mercurio, who are here with us this morning. If you happen to be newer to this church family, Chris and Faith served as a youth pastor couple for 9 years, and they've been with the Christian Missionary Alliance in Jordan for the past 4 years as international workers. And strangely, this morning, I was thinking about the fact, in the providence of God, the Mercurios, the Heatwalls, and the Fitzgeralds, who are all partner international workers with our church, they're all part of this church, and they serve the Lord other place. In the providence of God, God has seen fit to have them all here at the same time. And so what a blessing for us. If you haven't met any one of them, they will be here for a period of time, some shorter than others, but we encourage you to get to know them and connect with them and find out what God is doing in their lives as much as they would like to find out what the Lord is doing in your life. So praise the Lord for that. Guys, would you lead us in the worship of the Lord in song?
And come thou fount. Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. The streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love.
Here I raise
my Ebenezer, hither to thy help I come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. And Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. And how your kindness yet pursues me, how your mercy it never fails me, till the day that death shall loose me, I will sing, oh, I will sing. And oh, to grace how great made a debtor, and daily I'm constrained to be. And let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. How your kindness yet pursues me. How your mercy it never fails me. Till the day that death shall loose me, I will sing, oh, I will sing. Till the day that death shall loose me, I will sing, oh, I will sing. Prone to wander. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and within. And day and night they never cease to say, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who is seated on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created.
And between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders, I saw a lamb standing as though it had been slain, with seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. And he went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who is seated on the throne. And when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and your blood you ransomed people for God, from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth.
Sing, Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Sing, Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, 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 holy. is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Clothed in rainbows, clothed in rainbows of living color, flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder, blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Filled with wonder, filled with wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Yeah. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Let's sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing, sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Lord, we do give you praise and glory and honor this morning to the only one who is worthy of it, God. We thank you for what you've done on the cross for us, Lord. Thank you for what you do in our lives every and each day. God, pray you be with us as we continue this service, Lord, as we continue to worship you, Lord, as we continue to hear your word. Lord, be with us. We thank you for all this in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Good morning. Scripture reading this morning is Luke chapter 8, verse 4 through 18. And when a great crowd was gathering, and people from town after town came to him, he said in a parable, a sower went out to sow his seed, and as he sowed, some fell along the path and was trampled underfoot, and the birds of the air devoured it, and some fell on the rock. And it grew up, and as it grew up, it withered away because it had no moisture. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up with it and choked it. And some fell into good soil and grew and yielded 100-fold. As he said these things, he called out, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear."
And when his disciples asked him what this parable meant, he said, "To you it has been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of God, but for others they are in parables, so that seeing they may not see, and hearing they may not understand. Now the parable is this: the seed is the word of God. The ones along the path are those who have heard, then the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts, so that they may not believe and be saved. And the ones on the rock are those who, when they hear the word, receive it with joy. But these have no root. They believe it for a while, and in a time of testing fall away. And as for what fell among the thorns, they are those who hear, but they go on their way. They are choked by the cares and the riches and the pleasures of life, and their fruit does not mature. As for that, in good soil, they are those who, hearing the word, hold it fast in an honest and good heart and bear fruit with patience."
No one, after lighting a lamp, covers it with a jar or puts it under a bed, but puts it on a stand, so that those who enter may see the light. For nothing is hidden that will not be made manifest, nor is anything secret that will not be known and come to light. Take care, then, how you hear. For to the one who has, more will be given, and from the one who has not, even what he thinks he has will be taken away. This is the word of the Lord.
Boy, I hope that you were as encouraged as I was, just being able to worship the Lord in song, truly spirit-led, spirit-felt, and sensed worship. And I thank you for that. Often when I'm worshiping and having a hard time focusing my mind, I will stop and just listen to other people. And it helps me, and I hope that sometimes you can do that, that you might be led by the people of God. Paul says in Ephesians that we encourage one another as we sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to each other. And so I encourage you, when you are maybe restless or struggling or mind is distracted, just to say, "I'm going to listen to the people of God," and through that be able to enter into the presence of God. I thank you for your encouragement. It's a delight this morning to be able to turn to the Word of God. I hope that you have the Scriptures open there to Luke chapter 8, or turn them on, however it is that you get there. And we want to look at this passage of Scripture. Before we do, I'm going to pray for our young ones who are headed off to Kids and Praise this morning. And so if you're going that way, young ones, would you stand? And let me pray for you. Before I do, also I want to just make a quick update. Some of you have been tracking along with Andy and Janice Gardner, who are connected to this church also, been through here numerous times. They've been serving in the Lord in Guinea, West Africa. They have traveled back to the U.S. for some different reasons, and Andy has come down with a pretty strong case of malaria. And so he is here in Harrisonburg, but we would just want to pray for Andy's recovery. So would you join with me as we pray and ask the Lord's blessing on our time this morning? Our Father in heaven, we bow before you. We thank you. We come to you now in the Word of God, which is here. We thank you that the Scriptures are given to us so that we might not walk in darkness, but that we might have the light of life. And so, Lord, as we study this Word this morning, we would ask that you would give us understanding and insight into it, that you would enable us to grasp all that you have for us. Lord, we would pray that you would help us to hear well, to listen and to understand. Lord, we would pray that you would open eyes that are blind, hearts that are hard, ears that are stopped up, so that we might respond in faith, trust, and obedience. Lord, we ask your blessing on our young ones, our students, our children, that you would be with them as they go to their class, their time. We pray that you would give them also a heart and mind that would desire to know the Word of God and that would be planted in their heart today. And we ask that you would cause it to bear fruit in their lives. Be with our teachers, we pray. To ask your blessing on them as well. We do want to remember Andy this morning, just asking you, Lord Jesus, for your healing and touch on his body, that he might recover and regain strength, and Lord, that you would raise him up. Thank you that, Father, you care about the mind, the body, the spirit, the soul, the whole person, and so we would commit him to you. Now, Lord, as we look at this word, we ask for your spirit, that you would teach us by your spirit. And we commit ourselves to you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, if you've been with us over the last number of weeks, you know we've been working our way through a series of messages called Features of Discipleship. If you're new to our church, recently new, or just visiting this morning, we are doing a study of a series of messages through the summertime and into the early fall, asking the question, what does it mean to follow Jesus in discipleship? What does it look like for us to be a follower of Jesus? And I've been trying to communicate and get across the important thing that being a disciple isn't just a follower. Of course, that's the word we typically use, but also to understand it in terms of being a student, a learner. Or another word we've used is an apprentice. We are being taught by Jesus what it means to walk in the ways of God. We're being taught by him what it means to follow him in obedience and hearing his teaching and also his saving grace. And so today we come to this particular passage, Luke chapter 8. And what I've been saying over the past number of weeks, some of you might wonder, why is there a half-deflated what are these things called? Beach ball up here. And actually, the reason why I leave this kind of deflated is because I've been saying to you that this world that we're living in is passing away. And you are passing away, and I am passing away. And we can kind of have our whole focus on life. And I'm going to try to save my life. We talked about that last week. And everything be focused on this world and not understand and not recognize that this world is passing away. And that what the message of the gospel is that the kingdom of God has come and invaded this world. It's present in this world, but there's nothing about this world, nothing in our experience, nothing in our living that can access the kingdom of God. There's nothing that you can do, and we talked about how Jesus teaches us that the only way to access the kingdom of God, the only way to get to understand the kingdom of God, the only way to be able to perceive or see the kingdom of God is if you first experience the new birth. And we talked about John chapter 3 and the new birth, being born of God. And so, and last week we talked a little bit about one of the principal realities of the kingdom of God. One of the properties of it is Jesus gives to us the terms of the kingdom of God. And that is that we deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow him. But today we come to another piece of trying to understand the kingdom of God and understand one of its properties, one of its realities, and that is found here in Luke chapter 8 in this very famous parable that Jesus gives to us. I'm sure many of you are pretty familiar with it. You've probably heard many messages on it. You've probably read it many times, but maybe some of you here this morning, this is like your first time or maybe your second time coming in contact with this particular teaching. And so what I want to do this morning is to bring up this key truth. We're not going to look at everything that's in this passage. There's lots of things that are here. But this key truth, and that is simply this, that the kingdom of God, one of the properties or the realities of the kingdom of God is that the kingdom of God comes by hearing. The kingdom of God comes by hearing. Therefore, take care how you hear. Now, does that jar you? Does that surprise you? Is that shocking to you that the kingdom of God comes by hearing? I suspect it doesn't, but it ought to. And that's one of the things that we want to see this morning as we think about this piece of the kingdom of God. Let's begin by a couple of questions. Have you ever had the experience where you were trying to communicate something important to someone and you knew that the other person simply was not listening? You ever had that experience? They're distracted by their phone, the TV, the whatever. They weren't listening. Have you ever had the experience where you were trying to communicate something important to someone and the other person was listening, but they weren't hearing you? You ever been there? Somehow you're communicating, but it's not penetrating. It's not getting through, and you know they're not getting it for whatever reason. You ever had the experience where you were trying to communicate something important and the other person had already made up their mind, so no matter what you said, they weren't going to go along with it. They weren't going to even think about it. They had already come to preconceived ideas and convictions and conclusions. You ever been there? You ever done any of that to anybody? You know, this is a very common human experience, isn't it? And I want to say to you this morning that we all share that experience together. We've all had it happen to us, and we've all done it to someone else. And I want you to know that we all do it to God. And that's what this story, this parable, is about. The kingdom of God comes by hearing. Therefore, take care how you hear. Now, I want to do what we often wouldn't do with this particular passage of Scripture. Normally, in this passage of Scripture, you'd go through each one of these four soils. You know, the parable is about the sower who sowed the seed, and it fell on the rock, on the hard ground, and then on the rocky ground, and then on the ground with thorns, and then on the good soil. And normally, we would go through each one of those and think about those. But this morning, I want to do something different. I want to look at three pieces that Jesus gives to us: a seed, light, and the ear. Okay, we're just going to meditate a little bit on each one of those: a seed, light, and then the ear. So let's look at those. We're meditating a little bit on each one. And certainly this is no exhaustive treatment of these. This is to get you start to think about these things. First, the seed. I want you to see that Jesus teaches us that the nature of the kingdom of God is a seed, or as a seed. Look there in verse 10. He says to his disciples, he's speaking to them privately. First he preached to the crowd, now he's speaking to the disciples in a private conversation. And he says to them the secrets of the kingdom. See, he's talking to them about the kingdom. What's it like? What is it? What's its nature? What's its properties? So the kingdom of God is in view. And then he says in verse 11, the kingdom of God. Now the parable is this: the seed is the word of God. Matthew, the way Matthew records this in Matthew chapter 13, he says, whenever anyone hears the word of the kingdom. So the very first thing that Jesus teaches us is that we're supposed to think about the kingdom in terms of a seed. Jesus says that the word of God is a seed. Now, I want to ask a very important question that we have to think about, and that is, why would Jesus choose to use a seed as a metaphor for the kingdom? Lots of things out there that Jesus could have chosen, but he specifically chooses to pick up the metaphor of a seed. And so this morning I brought, and I know you're going to be thinking, if you keep doing this, we're going to have a garage sale around here. But each week, you know, there's something more. And so I brought one of my little trusty acorn. I keep this in my office because there's so many good illustrations in this. And I want us to meditate a little bit on why does Jesus use a seed to illustrate the nature of the kingdom of God? And I want to give you five things. We'll go through these quickly. The first is that a seed is rather unimpressive, isn't it? A seed is kind of weak looking. It's not that very, it doesn't appear that significant, impressive. I mean, if you were walking along and you saw a seed, would you go, whoa, seed, did you see that seed? Would you do that? No, you wouldn't do that, would you? Rather, what you do is you, oh, look at that seed. You know, look how it's made, what it is, what kind of seed it is. You pick it up, you look at it, you pick. A seed is rather unimpressive and in its appearance, kind of weak looking. Why would Jesus use a seed to explain the nature of the kingdom? He says the seed is the word of God. Now, who or what is the seed? Jesus is the Word of God, right? John chapter 1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. See? Jesus is the Word of God, or another way to put it is Jesus is the message from God. Jesus is bringing the kingdom of God. He is the message from God, come to this world. And the seed is the word that Jesus brings to us. How does Jesus come? Does Jesus come in power and glory and fanfare and a great explosion? He comes how? As a seed. Weak, unimpressive, seemingly insignificant. Isaiah says he came and we didn't think he was even worth looking at. Nobody, at least initially, was ever scared of Jesus. Even at the end of his life, the political powers that be, Rome, felt no threat by him. The religious leaders, of course, did feel a threat by Jesus, but it took quite a while for them to get there. They didn't really know what to do with him at first. Is he a threat? Isn't he a threat? You see, a seed comes in an unimpressive, rather insignificant form. And Jesus is the Word of God come in seed form. The second thing is that a seed is sown in the ground. And when it goes into the ground, it germinates and begins to grow. But when you first put a seed in the ground, what happens? Nothing. For a while, it looks as if nothing is happening. Days, maybe even a week goes by, sometimes two, depending on what it is, and there doesn't appear to be anything happening. When Jesus came into the world and he brought the kingdom of God, think about that, the kingdom of God, he brought the kingdom of God, and it appeared as if nothing was happening. Now, yes, there were healings and teaching that Jesus was doing, but a big question that the people were asking was, the kingdom of God is supposed to rid the world of all of the evil and rid the world and bring judgment, and yet, where was the conquering? In fact, John the Baptist sends his disciples to Jesus to ask him this very question. Are you the one? Or are we supposed to be looking for someone else? Because John was asking the question, I preached to the people that there was one coming after me whose sandals I wasn't worthy to untie, and that his threshing fork was in his hand, and he was going to clear the threshing floor with his winnowing fork. And John is asking the question, where's the conquering? You see, when a seed is sown, at first it appears as if nothing is taking place. Not only that, a seed, when it is sown, changes into something else. You ever thought about that? This seed is an acorn seed. But when it produces its life, does it pop out of the ground a whole bunch more acorns, like popcorn? Is that what comes out of the ground? No. The life that's in it, it changes its form into something else, and it produces a tree. You ever thought about that? Jesus came, and when his life was sown, what did he change into? It's called the what? The resurrection. You see, his life, it was still him. The seed, when it's sown in the ground, it's still itself, isn't it? But it's something else. And Jesus, when his life was sown in the ground, it changed. It was still him. They knew it was Jesus. But he was different. He was resurrected. He had a new kind of body, a new kind of existence. So not only is a seed that is sown in the ground changes its form, but also a seed transforms not by external power, but by internal power, internal realities. You ever thought about that? What is stronger, a seed or a wrecking ball? You see, a wrecking ball collapses against a building and explodes the building. You know, a wrecking ball comes through and just conquers everything in its path. But a seed has a power that's internal. You ever seen a seed grow in a place you're like, how in the heck did that tree grow there? We were traveling on a road down to in the Florida Keys and looked across, and there is a causeway that was an old causeway. It's dilapidated now. And in the middle of that causeway, on concrete, is a pine tree that's as tall as this building right here. And you go, how in the world did that pine tree grow there? See, a seed has power to transform by internal reality, not external. Now, when Jesus comes into the world, how does he conquer? Does he conquer by wrecking ball? Just clear everything out, blow everything up in his path? Or does he come into your life and change by the inside? You see, the kingdom of God is like the word of God is a seed. Lastly, when a seed is sown in the ground, does it stay a single seed? No, it multiplies, doesn't it? It multiplies. And when Jesus came into the world, in fact, in one place in John chapter 10 or 11, I think it is, John chapter 12, he says, unless a grain of sand fall into the ground, a grain of wheat fall into the ground and germinate, it remains alone. Unless a grain of wheat fall into the ground and die, it remains alone. But if it falls into the ground and dies, it produces a harvest. When Jesus was sown, his life was sown through the cross into death and came out on the other side in resurrection, did he remain alone? Oh, friends, can you see the church of Jesus Christ spread across this globe? His life has multiplied a million times over. Billions and billions of people throughout the generations on every continent have come to faith. Why? Because his life multiplied. So, first, Jesus wants us to grasp that the kingdom of God is a seed. It's very important. Let's move on. The nature of the kingdom as light. Now, look down there in verse 18. We're jumping down to verse 18, and what does he say? No one, after lighting, okay, again, he's speaking to his disciples in his private conversation. He says, no one, after lighting a lamp, covers it with a jar or puts it under a bed, but puts it on a stand so that those who enter may see the light. For nothing is hidden that will not be made manifest, nor anything secret that will not be known and come to light. Take care, then, how you hear. For to one, to the one who has, more will be given, and from the one who has not, even what he thinks he has will be taken away. Now, what is Jesus saying to us here? Some places in the New Testament, when light is used, it's speaking about God. God is light. Sometimes when light is used, it's speaking about Jesus or Jesus' teaching, and sometimes when light is used, it's talking about Jesus' followers. In Matthew chapter 5, what does Jesus say? You are the light of the world, talking to his disciples. Now, which of those three is it here? And I want to suggest to you, after thinking a lot about this and wrestling and reading, I'm convinced that what Jesus is speaking to us about here is that he is speaking about himself and his teaching. Let me show you why I've come to that conclusion. No one, after lighting a lamp, covers it with a jar or puts it under a bed, but instead puts it on its stand so that it may enter, that those who enter may see the light. Now, if you take a flashlight or any light, and when you're using a light, do you turn it on and set it on a lampstand like that, on your table like that? Is that useful? That helpful? No, you don't do it like that, do you? Rather, you use the light the way it was designed, to give light. So the very first thing is the light has a purpose to it. And you don't violate the purpose. The light's purpose is that it would be put on the stand. And when it's put on its stand and it's used, what happens to the darkness? You go into a dark room and you use the light and you put it on its stand. What happens to the darkness? It flees, right? The darkness flees. The light causes the darkness to run away. And not only does that happen, but when you put light on its stand, not only does the darkness flee, but then you are enabled to see. So it gives light to everyone who enters. Now, what is Jesus trying to get across to us is simply this. Jesus and his teaching are the light. And even though he has come in seed form, even though his teaching is seed-like and all those things that we talked about, nevertheless, his light and his teaching, or excuse me, his life and his teaching are shining light into the darkness so that those who see may enter. You see, everyone, even though he's come in this seed form, everyone who sees his work and listens to his teaching are seeing the light of the kingdom. It's present, it's visible, it's accessible. And his teaching is dispelling the darkness. It's causing the darkness to flee. When John the Baptist asked the question to Jesus and sent his disciples there, and they said to him, "Are you the one? Are we supposed to be looking for another?" What does Jesus say? How does he respond to them? At first, he doesn't say anything. But immediately, he goes and he heals all kinds of people. And then he says to John's disciples, "Go back and tell John what you have seen and heard. The blind receive their sight. The mute are able to speak. The lame are able to walk. And the poor have the gospel preached to them." Do you see what Jesus is saying? The kingdom of God is like a seed. It's come in seed form. The word of God is a seed. But nevertheless, it's visible. It's present. It's able to be it's accessible to us. Which brings me to the final point this morning. The necessity of hearing. If it's true, and it is, that the kingdom of God comes by hearing, are you beginning to get a sense of why that is so jarring and so surprising and so otherworldly? Every other earthly kingdom comes by what? Every earthly kingdom that you know about comes by what? Power. Every other earthly kingdom is a wrecking ball. Every earthly kingdom you know, just think through the earthly kingdoms. How do they come into the world? Alexander the Great, the Pharaohs, the Romans in the Middle Ages, the Ottoman Empire. Pick your empire. How does it come? It comes conquering by power. Do you ever have any Do you ever have any fear or understanding if you're in it or out of it? You see, the kingdom of God comes, or excuse me, the kingdoms on this earth come by power. You know if you're in it or you're outside of it. You either submit to it or it kills you. Every kingdom on this earth comes by power. But the kingdom of heaven comes by what? By hearing. Why? What's the difference? The difference is simply this. The kingdom of God is a word to you. It is a message to you. And because it is a message, because it is a word, hearing is absolutely critical. Because if you do not hear, if you do not understand, it will pass you by. You see, the kingdom of heaven is news that has hit the newsstand. Have you ever contrasted in your own mind the nature of the kingdoms of this world? They're like a wrecking ball. But the nature of the kingdom of God is like a seed. It's a message. And because it's a message, you have to decide, do I believe it or don't I believe it? You have to gain access to it. You have to understand it. Someone has said that listening is the primary skill of the kingdom of God. And Jesus is saying to us, all other kingdoms in this earth will pass away. They're all wrecking balls. But my message, my kingdom is different. It's very easy to miss. It's very easy to reject. It's very easy to mix in with your agenda. You have to think about it. You have to reflect on it. You have to consider it. You have to slow down and listen and hear. Amen. You have to think about what you're hearing. And let me just go a little further and press this even harder upon us. If you think that you have understood the message of the kingdom of God, if you think that I've got it, I understand it, I've got it, it makes all sense, I'm there, you haven't gotten it at all. Listen to me. Churches are filled with people who think that they are in the kingdom and they're not. Filled with people who are saying, I've heard you. And Jesus is saying, you haven't heard me at all. Notice how many times Jesus talks about hearing in this passage. Verse 8, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. Verse 12, those along the path are those who have heard. Verse 13, they hear the word. Verse 14, those who hear. Verse 50, those who hearing the word. And then verse 18, take care then how you hear. What does hearing require of us? In a world that's as frenetic and fast-paced as our world, hearing requires slowing down, listening, thinking, understanding, talking it out with other people, considering its implications, not letting any distractions, no preconceived ideas or commitments, no made-up minds before you've actually heard what it's about. Oh, brothers and sisters, friends, there are so many people who have rejected the message of the kingdom of God, and they don't even know what they're rejecting. As I close this morning, I want to just point you briefly that this parable of the seed of the sower or the seed sown is really a parable on four ways that people hear. We'll just go through them very briefly. Or you might even say four tests to our hearing. The first one is the one who hears with a hard heart, Jesus says. The seed falls on the path, it's hard. And they reject it outright. They already have made up their mind. They haven't heard. They might have heard the message, but it's all intellectual. It's all in the head. There's been no power of God that has penetrated through their minds into realizing, this is something for me. They may have heard something of the truth, but has no bearing on them. To them, Jesus is a concept, an idea, a set of maxims. Maybe they can even give you all the right answers, but it hasn't penetrated. Jesus is maybe a teacher, but not a savior. The second is those who have heard with not a hard heart, but a shallow heart. The word gets in, they receive it with joy, but it's all emotions. It's all emotional. It's a message that they like. But Jesus says when life gets tough, they're out of there. See, when it costs something to be a Christian, they flee, they run. In many ways, they only believe the word about Jesus so long as it works for them. They're the kind of people who want to not come into Jesus' kingdom, they want to bring Jesus into their kingdom. In a lot of ways, it's a cost-benefit analysis. When the costs are higher than the benefits, they're gone. And the real gods are the things that they're losing. Hard heart, shallow heart. The third is one who hears with a divided heart. You see, the word gets in, it's there, but there's no fruit. Why? Because divided loyalties. Jesus says the cares and riches and concerns of this world choke the word so that it bears no fruit. See, these are people that are trying to serve God and money and something else. In a lot of ways, this is the most dangerous group to be in. Do you know why? Because there's just enough of God in there to make you think that you're okay. But you don't realize that you're dying a slow death. And then, of course, not only a hard heart and a shallow heart and a divided heart, but then lastly, the fourth group is those who hear the word. And you know, I noticed something I've never seen before this week, and that is that in every part of this story, Jesus speaks in the past tense. The hard heart, shallow heart, divided heart, they all heard the word. But when he speaks about the ones who respond, he says, as for the good soil, those are those who, what? Hearing. Present tense, present reality. You know what he's saying? You know what he's getting at? He's saying, they're the people who hold on to it. They're thinking it out. They're wrestling with it. They're working it. They're trying to understand. They're trying to grasp it. They're allowing the seed to penetrate down into their heart and into their life. Present active. And because they do that, they bear fruit. And he adds the little phrase, with patience. As I close, how do you know when you're really listening? How do you know when you're really listening? Verse 18 gives us the clue. Excuse me, verse 18. Take care then how you hear. For to the one who has, more will be given. How do you know when you're really listening? And the answer is when you're acting on it. See, Jesus says, to the one who has, more will be given. Translation, to the one who has heard and acts, God adds more understanding. God gives more insight. God gives more blessing because you have taken his word by faith and taken a step in obedience towards him. You're not there. You're learning. You're an apprentice. To the one who has, more will be given. And if you don't, if you're wondering, are you sure that about that? Look up at verse 21. Jesus says, my mother and my brothers are those who what? Hear the word of God and do it. Jesus is teaching us this principle. If you hear the word, you know you're listening when you act upon that word. And when you act upon that word, God gives more understanding. And when you act upon that word, God gives you more understanding. You see, the word of God is a seed. The word of God is light. And when you act upon those understandings and you hear and are listening, God grants more understanding, more insight. How are you doing at hearing? How are you doing at listening? The word of God is a seed. The word of God is light. Take care then how you hear. How are you doing? How am I doing? Are you hearing? Are you listening? Are you trying to understand? Are you gaining insight? When you receive an understanding, do you take it and act upon it so that God might grant even more insight? Or is it all intellectual? Is it all emotional? Already preconceived ideas? Is it a divided kind of heart? Kingdom of God comes by hearing. Take care how you hear. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, Jesus, how you want us to understand, how you want us to grasp, how you want us to receive, how you want us to take hold, how you want us to experience the life that you have provided. You didn't come into the world to conquer it, not to conquer individual lives. You came into the world to conquer sin and death. The sin and death that's inside of us, that's what you wanted to conquer. And you conquered it by laying your life down on the cross. And then, having conquered sin and death, you offer your life to us so that if we are willing to receive you as the Word of God, the very seed of God, you will come in, begin to change us, powerfully, you begin to make us new, you transform us. All those realities, Lord, become present in us. Lord, I think this morning there's probably someone in this room who's never trusted you, never understood, never taken hold. Lord, this morning I pray that they would hear, begin to think, begin to consider, begin to pursue. Take a small step toward you. And Jesus, I pray that you would respond to them by giving them more. And Lord, for some of us who've walked with you for some time, oh Lord, would you help us never to think we understand it all, we've got it figured out. But rather, Lord, might we be hearing, thinking out the realities, challenging one another, talking about them together, so that we might walk in the light of life. Help us, Lord, we pray. Thank you that you are tender, patient, Help us, Lord, to persevere, and that the seed of God might fall into good soil and produce a harvest. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
You can stand and join us in worship as we sing, "Yet Not I, But Through Christ in Me." Sing, "What Gift of Grace." What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken. For by my side, the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing. For in my need, His power is displayed. To this I hold, my shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley He will lead. Though the night has been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ in me. No fate I dread, no fate I dread, I know I am forgiven. The future sure, the price it has been paid. For Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. Though the chains are released, I can sing, I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Sing with every breath I know. With every breath I long to follow Jesus, for He has said that He will bring me home. And day by day I know He will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, all the glory evermore to Him. And when the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. When the race is complete, still my lips shall repeat, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Amen. I hope that that is the cry of your heart, yet not I, but through Christ in me. Praise his name. Just a few things before I release us this morning. I just want to remind all of you that I mentioned last week that I attended the CMA General Council the past week, and there were some decisions that were made that we want to make the congregation informed about. And so next Sunday on the 25th, following the morning service in the fellowship hall, we will take some time to be able to do that. If you are available and so disposed to be there, we want to invite you to participate in that. Also, would like just to remind you that at the end of every service, we always provide some of our elders here. If God has spoken to you this morning, or if you are carrying a burden and you just need someone to pray with you about a particular thing that you need just prayer with, we want to invite you to take advantage of that. Our elders and their wives are happy to do that. And then finally, there's a potluck, time to eat. We're looking forward to that. If you are able to stay, we want to welcome you. As was said earlier, if you didn't come prepared, didn't bring anything, please come. We're happy to have you anyways. Be able to celebrate Father's Day together. Let me pray for the food, and we'll just invite you to go straight into the fellowship hall, and we'll be able to eat and enjoy good fellowship together. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for this morning and for the teaching of the Word of God. We pray that you would help us, Lord, truly to hear and to grasp, to understand. Lord, to listen well, not have preconceived ideas, but rather, Lord, to pay attention. Father, I pray that you would bless this congregation with your presence and power and grace. Lord, we thank you for the food that you've provided. We ask that it would be strengthening to our bodies, that we might find rich enjoyment around a table of food and good conversation. And so, Lord, we bless your name. And we give you praise. Now unto him who is able to do exceedingly more abundantly, more than we could ever ask or imagine, according to him who's at work in us through his power, be a glory, power, now and forevermore. God's grace be with you. You're dismissed.